In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. Welcome to Living Word Baptist Church, where the Word of God comes alive. Our mission is to exalt the Savior, equip the saint, evangelize the sinner, and empower the community. Our pastor and first lady are Reginald and Vanessa Fletcher. Please enjoy this recording of a portion of one of our Sunday morning services, and stay tuned at the end for general information about our exciting ministry and how you can get involved. Now, let's enter in and be blessed.
Oh God, we thank you for this time of praise and worship. But more importantly, oh God, we lay our all on the altar that you have sacrificed. We come before you, dear gracious Father, as an empty vessel, needing to be filled with your mercy and your power. Paul said that all things work together for the good, them that are called for your purpose. We pray, O God, that you would use us in your calling to give purpose to the lives of these under the sound of my voice, to challenge them to trust you no matter what the circumstances may look like. Share with us in your word that faith is the substance, things not seen. I don't see how you're going to work it out, but I know you will. Oh God, I pray now that you would move on me and in me, through me, that I might proclaim your truth. Give me preaching power, that I might proclaim your gospel. For I hear you say in your word, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Oh God, I pray now for this waiting congregation, that we might know that with you we can do all things. Because of you, we are all things. But oh God, if I stand with too much fear in my heart, I pray that you give me courage. If I stand too arrogantly, pray that you would humble me. Remind me that I am nothing without thee. will be careful to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Yes. Tissue. Yes. There's a towel on my desk. Oh, where is it? Oh, they done took it. We thank God afresh for this another Lord's Day. We, Vanessa and I, have been on Mount Sinai, and we found that the Lord said, the ground on which you stand is holy ground. Kick off your shoes. I want to share with us from 14th chapter of the book of Mark. I want to read into your hearing the first 11 verses of the text. Then I want to take just a few minutes. I want to talk about betrayal in the middle of an anointing. Betrayal in the middle of an anointing. From the King James Version, it reads, thank you, thusly, after 2 days was the feast of the Passover and of unleavened bread. And the chief priests and the scribes sought how they might take him by craft and put him to death. But they said, not on the feast day, lest there be an uproar of the people. And being in Bethany in the house of Simeon the leper, or Simon the leper, as he sat at meat, there came a woman having an alabaster box of an ointment of spikenard, very precious, and she broke the box and poured it on his head. And there were some that had indignation within themselves and said, why was this waste of ointment made? For it might have been sold for more than 300 pence or denarii and have been given to the poor. And they murmured against her. And Jesus said, let her alone. Why trouble ye her? She hath wrought a good work on me. For ye have the poor with you always, and whensoever ye will be, may do them good. But me ye have not always. She hath done what she could. She is coming aforehand to anoint my body for to the burying. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her. And Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went unto the chief priests to betray him unto them. And when they heard it, they were glad and promised to to give him money. And he sought how he might conveniently betray him. Betrayal in the middle of an anointing. You might be seated in the presence of the Lord. In this text, we'll try not to be long. There's a lot in this text. But I want to lift out one point to us. Your destruction doesn't come from outside of you, but your destruction comes from within. Your fear does not come from outside of you, but your fears come from within. In this text, Jesus has begun the Passion Week, and the scribes and the chief priests had been looking since chapter 2 for a way to kill him. They were upset with his teaching. They were upset with his preaching. They were upset with his miracle workers. They were upset with even those who followed after him. And so we find them at the opening of this text looking for a way, and the scripture teaches us plainly to kill him. They figured they could not discredit him. They could not deter him. They could not discourage him, so they sought to kill him. Then in our lives, when you stand for something of value, when you stand for something in a positive and in a godly nature, people will seek to kill you also. They will assassinate your character, spit and spew lies about you, or they will even take the truth and twist it. But we have not to yield to their assassination. We don't have to crumble under the pressure of the conversations that they have about us. For we have something within us that will hold back the rain. Something within us that we cannot explain. And that something is Jesus. In this text, they had gathered together to assassinate him. And the thing that is so interesting is that he knew every thought that they had. Sometimes you find yourself, you know, somebody don't like you. You know when they really don't know you, don't mean you any good. And you go into their presence anyway. Some of you go into their presence just to aggravate the hell out of them, so they can put the hell on you. But you ought to be like Christ. I'm going to be in the midst of them because of the purpose of which I am called. I'm called to be an example of Christ. I'm not called to retaliate against their assassinations and their bullets that they fire at me. I'm called to put on the whole armor of God and stand when they've done all to for me to tear me down. I've got to learn how to keep standing. The opening of this text lays out the plot to kill Jesus. Many of us in this room, there's a plot, even as we speak, to kill you. It might be to assassinate your character. It might be to disrupt your family. It might be even to discourage your faith. But nonetheless, there's a plot against us in society. If you claim to be a child of God today, you might as well get ready, because folk don't believe in God no more. They would rather go downtown and party all night long, like Prince, like it's 1999. I want to know what's significant about 1999. Could it be that there was a rumor that the world was coming to an end in 2000? And I might as well get my party on before the end comes? There's a plot against the body of Christ. There's a plot against you and I. But there is an understanding. We are betrayed not by those that are outside of us, but there is a betrayal from within our ranks. The plot comes from the Sadducees and the Pharisees. They were supposedly the church folk. There's a new hashtag millennials got going around now, gotten quite a bit of attention. Hashtag church hurt. And people go on to this hashtag and they display how they were hurt by the church. Well, got a question about that. Jesus said in Matthew 16, upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. But when I ask the question, dig a little bit deeper, I need to understand, how is the church made up? What is the church made up of? Church is made up of a bunch of knotheads and screw-ups. Folk that had made a few mistakes along the way. And even after they've gotten into the body of Christ and they're in their comfort zone, they still are messing up. Many of us come into the body of Christ because we is hurt. So what makes you think that church don't hurt? You hurt. And you are the church. This building does not make a church. It is only those of us who enter into the gates that make up the church. You know why hashtag church hurt hurts? is because it's the way we enter into his gates. The scripture says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Oh, be thankful unto him and bless his name. But there's a plot against him. And if the plot is against him, and you belong to him, the plot is against you too. The question is, how are you going to handle the plot? How are you going to handle the attack? Right in the Markian scripture, Mark has a unique way of placing scripture. He makes a Reuben sandwich here. He's got rye on the bottom. That's the plot. He's got rye on the top. That's the betrayal. But in the midst, he's got corned beef from the choices of the stock. He's got a little bit of sauerkraut for the bitterness of life. But he sweetens it up with a little bit of Thousand Island dressing. And in the midst of rye bread, he places all of this good stuff. And we got a sandwich. Can I talk about the rye, the sauerkraut, and the Thousand Island? Come on, Doris. Scripture says in verse 3, and they were in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, and a woman. Now, the book of Mark does not name this woman. But in John, they assume, some scholars assume, that it was Mary, the sister of Lazarus, when she anointed Jesus, not only his head, but also his feet. And she then wiped the excess down with her hair. But listen in this text. I don't want to stay here too long, but there's a whole lot here for us to gather and glean. The first thing we see in this text was the place that they found. Jesus was at Bethany. And when Jesus came back, he taught in Jerusalem, but he never spent the night in Jerusalem. Isn't that funny? He did all of his teaching in Jerusalem. But his lodging was outside of the city. That's interesting. Because if he had to rest outside, but he had to work inside, what was the significance of the hurt on the message of Jesus? Listen to this thing. It wasn't Bethany that was falling apart. It was Jerusalem. It was not Bethany that they would hang him on a tree. It was Jerusalem. It was not Bethany that he would face Pilate as a trial, but it was Jerusalem. Betrayal in the midst of an anointing. the outside could not affect him, but the inside changed him. Listen to this text. In Bethany, Jesus sat at the table with his disciples, and they were fellowshipping one with another. In a place, gathering, family, and close relatives together. And this woman brings alabaster box with spikenard and nard, an expensive ointment. And she anoints Jesus. But listen to how she does it. She breaks open the alabaster box.
All right.
And then she pours on him the ointment that is within. Now there's some significance to her breaking the box, because that says to us that she wasn't going to use this for anything else but the anointing of Jesus. When she broke open the box, she was saying that I'm placing my all on the altar. I'm giving Christ everything that I have. It reminds me of the woman in the previous chapter when Jesus stood on the side and watched the giving, and he watched the rich and the poor, and he said, this woman who gave two mites has given more than the rich, because they have given out of their abundance, but she has given out of her all. The one thing you have to be mindful of is that this woman had made a commitment to give Christ everything that she had. But then, inside the house, once she anoints Jesus, the betrayal stirs up. Listen to the text. The disciples didn't even have enough nerve, enough courage to openly assassinate her. The scripture says that they had indignation within. It wasn't that they attacked her openly, but they had indignation on the inside.
All right.
That's why the scripture says, you know, you be careful about what you think.
Yeah.
Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. You call yourself a child of God, but you thinking worldly things. You see, you got to peel that off every day.
Yes.
Paul said it like this. Each and every day I pull off the old man that I might put on the new man. Why should I put on the new man? Because the old man inside of me is tainted. The old man inside of me got some problems. The old man inside of me got some hang-ups. But when we look at this text, we see them rationalizing their indignation. Don't you know what we could have done with that oil? We could have sold that and given to the poor. Now, you know, one of the things you need to be mindful of is that, you know, we just had the food pantry yesterday, and we do Great job with the food pantry. But don't bank your reward on your good feeling of giving somebody some day-old oranges. Don't get happy about what you do. Be concerned with the motive that you do. Because it's not in what you do that counts. It's the motive with which you do that counts. Listen to the text. Jesus said, after they had jumped on this woman, he said, listen, why are y'all jumping on her? Leave her alone. Because what she's doing is more than what you were even thinking about. Listen to the text. He says to us, they had rationalized, we could give this money to the poor. Mark does not say which disciple it was, but John assumes that it was Judas that stirred up the bunch. There was some things that you need to be mindful of. Judas, first and foremost, he was not a Galilean. He didn't come from the hood, so he didn't really know Jesus like the rest of them knew Jesus. Judas was a thief. He had been stealing from the kitty. But the thing that you need to be mindful of is that Jesus, in his explanation, said he did not compare him to the poor, but he compared both of them to discipleship. He says, listen to the text. He says, the poor you will have with you always, but me will not be with you always. In other words, he did not compare himself to the poor, but he compared the opportunity to disciple with others and bring them into the body of Christ. The challenge for us is to understand that our destruction does not come from without, but it comes from within. Mary wasn't one of Jesus' inner circle disciples, but she was a disciple nonetheless. She was on the outskirts. She was a perimeter. She was a suburb of the disciples. But yet and still, her offering was from her heart. Problem we have is that when we look at the text, the corned beef is Jesus defending Mary. That's the meat of the text. Because when she began to offer her sacrifices unto him, she poured out everything that was in her.
All right.
Because the assumption is that this expensive ointment was a family heirloom. It had, not only did it have value, but it also had sentiment. She gave all that she had from her heart. How many of us, we come to worship, we in a hurry, we watching our clocks, and we nervous about somebody, or we watching somebody else. That ain't them. That's you. Let me close. On the outside, church had sought to destroy Christ. But they could not get at Christ without inside help.
All right.
So he goes through this anointing or this interaction outside Jerusalem to give us a picture of what's going to happen in Jerusalem. The same thing that we need to look at in our lives. Your family is not destroyed by the folk in the hood. Your family is destroyed by the folk in the house. It's not the man on the street that is siphoning the life out of you. It's the man in the bed with you. It's not the woman in the alley that's taken the very substance from you, but it's the woman in your kitchen that's preparing your meal. So what do we do about this, Lynn? Jesus gives us perfect example. Because in this text, even though he knew that his betrayer would come from within his inner circle, he never broke up his inner circle. He did not attack Judas, but he lifted up and encouraged Judas. We'll find later on in the text where they are in the Last Supper and he says, one of you will betray me.
All right.
They started asking questions, which one is it? The one that dips in the dish with me. Right then it was Judas. But then he says to him, he says, listen, if you're going to do it quick. But Jesus never belittled him, and he never cast him out. But listen to the text. Verse 10. And Judas went and sought the chief priest. Now, the first thing he did was he went to look for them. He knew of the plot. He knew that they were looking for an inside option for the plot. So he became that option. So he goes and seeks them. What's the lesson? Ask yourself a question. Have you betrayed Christ? You right here in the church. You living life to the fullest. And the outside influences have allowed you to connect with them. So you've gone to shaking and dipping. slipping and creeping, shacking and racking. I'm just saying it like it is. Ain't no difference in your way of life than those in the world. There ought to be some difference if you say that you are a child of the King. There ought to be some places that you just refuse to go. It ain't like you can't go, but there ought to be a standard in your life. That Jesus won't let me go there anymore. Jesus won't let me talk like that anymore. Jesus won't let me think like that anymore. Why? Because the gospel is in me. And you know the thing that's so awesome about this text is that the thing that can betray you and destroy you is within you. But the thing that can deliver you, that can keep you, that can hold you when you can't hold yourself, is also in you. My life is built on nothing less than Jesus' love and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly, I wholly lean on Jesus' name. Oh, Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Paul said it like this: for to me to live is Christ. I can't just live any kind of way. I can't just walk any kind of way. I just can't talk any kind of way. Whatever I say, whatever I do, I represent Christ Jesus. It's not enough just to be in the place, but I gotta have a place in me. I gotta have a walk in me. I gotta have a talk in me that makes a difference in me, that I might make a difference in the world. Listen, I can't leave you there. Jesus was preparing for Calvary. He was teaching his disciples that it's not what's on you that counts. It's not who you hang out with, but it is the heart that is within you. He was on his way to Gethsemane to talk to his father, to negotiate with his father. And when he got to the place where he was about to give up, his father shared with him, "Son, I love you." That's why I say, I remember, I hear him saying, "Father, if it be thy will, let this cup pass from me." But he said, not my will, but your will be done. And you see, the thing that's so awesome in this text, I don't believe God verbally said anything to Jesus in Gethsemane. I believe he just touched him on his shoulder. And he reminded him, just as you've reminded your disciples, "Lo, I'm with you.
All the way.
All the way.
Come on now.
Unto the end." Not just of the end of the battle.
That's right.
Not just the end of the race. Not just the end of the city. Not just the end, but the end of the age. No matter what you're going through, no matter how you're going through it, God has made a way. And he has promised never to leave you. Never to leave you alone. Betrayal in the middle of an anointing. You've been anointed. But there's betrayal all around you. The question is, what will you do with the anointing? Because I know
go ahead.
I'm trying to cut it off, Reuben. The scripture says that what Mary is doing is she is preparing me for my burial. I'm going to be killed and stabbed, hung on a tree in shame, speared in the side. They're not going to have time to anoint me for my burial. So she's already putting it in place. God will work it out for you. In spite of what you're going through, in spite of how you're going through it, he's already worked it out. He's already made a way out of no way. He's already moved molehills out of your way. But then, in this text, the anointing prepared him to hang on Calvary's tree. The anointing had prepared him. You own it, man. You own it. Had prepared him in spite of who was around him. Thank you, Andre. Thou preparest a table in the presence of mine enemies. Right in the midst of all his trouble, right in the place where he thought he was safe, his enemies were all around him. And yet, in spite of his enemies being around him, he said, thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. In the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Betrayal in the middle of an anointing. You got an anointing, and the reason for that anointing is to cover you in the betrayal that is coming in your life. It's not a maybe. It's not a might. It's on the way. And if you got the anointing, he'll prepare a table right in the midst of those who are betraying you. He'll prepare a table in the midst of those that want to destroy you. But you gotta trust him. You gotta trust him. You gotta trust him. You gotta trust him. You can't live any kind of way. You can't think any kind of way. You can't walk any kind of way. You gotta trust him with everything that you got. You gotta trust him when you're good. You gotta trust him when it's bad. You gotta trust him when you got a table full of food. You gotta trust him when your refrigerator is empty. You gotta trust him when you got a house full of friends. You gotta trust him when you're all by yourself. You gotta trust him when your health is good. You gotta trust him when your health is bad. You gotta trust him when nobody else loves you. You gotta trust him. You gotta trust him. You gotta trust him. You gotta trust him. For he has anointed you. church open. You got to trust him. You got to trust him. You got to trust him. You got to trust him.
Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Beloved, we are thankful, excited, and humbled that you decided to worship with us today. We pray this recording has been a blessing to you, and that you are not the same person you were before you heard it. If you're interested in worshiping with us again, our normal Sunday morning service times begin with Sunday school for all ages starting at 9 a.m. And our Sunday morning worship and celebration begins at 10:15 a.m. We also have midweek Wednesday Bible study at two convenient times, either 12 noon or 6:30 p.m. For more information about our church and other ministries, please check out our website at www.lwbcindy.org. That's www.lwbcindy.org. Or friend us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at lwbcindy. Beloved, we just want you to know we love you, and remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. May God bless you and keep you.